Welcome back to our channel. It's Amanda, and today we are going to do our first true crime video. We are going to be talking about the disappearance of Jason Landry. It's been in the news lately, so I thought that I would go ahead and cover it since they are still searching. Right now, we don't have a whole lot of information, but I'm going to give you like the facts, talk about what I found in my research, and then we're going to get into the theories. So Jason is a 21-year-old college student. He is from Missouri City and he is currently attending Texas State University in San Marcos. On December 13th, around 10:30, 11 p.m., Jason packed up his apartment and headed back to Missouri City for Christmas break. About 30 minutes into his drive, he did get into a car crash. And that was in Lulling, Texas. Around 12:31 a.m. on December 14th, 2020, volunteer firefighter found Jason's car at the 2300 block of Salt Flat Road. The lights were still on inside the vehicle and the passenger side door was locked. The rear driver's side made contact with a tree on the eastbound side of the highway and it forced the driver's side to hit a tree and then get stuck in between a barbed wire fence there. During that collision, the back rear window was completely shattered. The car has been sent off and checked for DNA. So there's not any evidence at the moment that suggests another vehicle was involved or some sort of outside force pushed him into the side. Jason's cell phone was found by his father. It was in between the seat and the center console. And then about 900 feet or so away from his car, his father found Jason's clothes. He had found a t-shirt, shorts, underwear, socks, some slides. His father released his clothing to the investigators and they did run it through DNA and evidence, and it did have a tiny smear of blood on one of the articles of clothing, which it could have been from the barbed wire or something. Maybe it like got caught and it made him bleed. They also discovered a backpack. So in the backpack, they found a ball cap, his wallet, a small bag of toiletries, and a little bit of marijuana, his laptop, and also some gaming equipment. Also found his Betafish on the ground near his things. So it just really doesn't make sense. Like, where did he go? Did he get in the crash and then kind of get disoriented, get out of the car, or did somebody come to help him and he willingly got out and then a struggle happened? Investigators did gain access to his cell phone records and it shows Jason's location up until the crash site, until he passed through the intersection of Hackberry Street and Highway 80, where Jason was using the Waze app to get home. Where it turns into Austin Street, it switched to Snapchat and we don't know who he was snapping at the moment. I'm just gonna put my two cents in here. If you're chatting with somebody, I'm sure many of you know that if you do not save the message, it will just disappear after you open it and switch out of that chat. So maybe he was, since he did have a little bit of marijuana on him, maybe he was meeting up with somebody. Maybe he witnessed something he wasn't supposed to see. You know, maybe there was foul play. There's no evidence right now to suggest that. Texas Search and Rescue, or TxR, had done a search and rescue mission for him for about a week to 2 weeks, and they suspended the search on February 26, 2021 at 8 a.m. TxR did continue the ongoing investigation, and that was at the request of the Caldwell County Sheriff's Department. Search and rescue canines that are trained in human remains detection, water resources, and a helicopter. So as of right now, they're still searching for him. I think they have like over 100 volunteers like that are family and friends that are helping. Those are all the facts of the case that really I could find. I'm gonna go into what the family has said because I did listen to the True Crime Chronicles podcast called Driving Home. So his dad said that he was the one that found Jason's belongings and he's the only one that took a video or picture of the evidence in that scene. He said that it didn't appear like anybody had been searching for him. His ex-girlfriend had made a pretty lengthy post, so you can tell she's truly heartbroken and wants him to come home. She is working with authorities, answering questions. They don't think that she's a suspect, and they don't think any of the family is a suspect at all at this time. One of the students from Texas State had mentioned that they did not receive a student email regarding his disappearance, and there was a article in their newspaper, but they said that not a whole lot of people read that, and they feel like it should have been talked about more by the dean, but nobody said anything. Kent is hoping that the investigators can get a geofence warrant. It's like a box around the crime scene that can tell at the date and time if there's any other cell phones in the area. They're really hoping that the judge approves that. Recording of the officer and dispatch call, I did get to listen to that. It's actually pretty accessible. People were posting it. There's a part in it that I really don't understand, and a lot of other people are talking about it too. Around 12 minutes, the officer or somebody, it comes from the officer's radio, says he screamed like a girl. To me, it sounds like a younger male saying it than near the officer, but it's apparent that that is what's said. You can hear it clear as day. And then they just start talking about, okay, you need to get in contact with the owner of the vehicle, which was Lisa, his mom, to let them know that the car is abandoned on the side of the highway. So I don't know what that was. Maybe we'll find that out later. But I thought I would throw that in there because that was just really weird to me. His dad said this was Jason's first time driving through Loling at night. He had only driven through that city to get to his hometown a couple times, and it had been in the day or the afternoon. He also said that some of the lights at the intersection were down, and maybe that one was messing up, or it was like a blinking light or something of that nature, and it confused him. The dad talks about how Jason was getting his footing in at Texas State. It was his first semester of college. Jason was hoping to get into the prestigious sound technology program before he went missing. When he came home for Thanksgiving break, he said that he kind of wanted a fresh start and that he had been a little lonely just because of all the COVID restrictions. And during this time, I think we're all a little lonely and kind of going through it, stress and anxiety, and his dad said that that was very apparent when he was at home. His dad also said that when he drove down to Loling to go to the impound lot, he went to the crash site, obviously, and he said that while he was driving in a rural area, he said he didn't see any other cars and that there was like just deer walking around. Maybe he could have swerved to not hit a deer, overcorrected, and that's how he got in a crash. As far as the clothes being in the middle of the roadway, his dad said that typically when people get hypothermia, their brain kind of plays a trick on them and they think that they're actually really hot when they're not and they're cold. And since this was in December in Texas, I'm sure that at some point in the night it was colder than normal, and maybe he did get that and he just stripped his clothes off and just left, or he got disoriented and got, you know, a concussion and started just walking around and just took off his clothes. I think his dad said that I 100% agree with as being a parent. A lot of people might not agree with this, and that's what his dad said too, is that the thing that really could have helped them during this investigation was knowing Jason's passcode. Apparently it was a lengthy passcode for his phone to unlock. If they had known it, it would have helped. Dad has suggested on the podcast, give it your passcode to one person. It could be a friend, a parent, a grandparent, a sibling, a cousin, whatever. Just, you know, make a pact. Like, if something were to happen to me, or only in this situation, you can use this passcode. Because he obviously wants his son to have privacy, but he said if that would have been a factor, it would have helped out greatly in the investigation. He could have gotten into his messages. He could have gotten into his Snapchat and if he had saved anything. Okay, so the theories. My theory is that he went to meet up with somebody on his way home to get some weed, and maybe he witnessed something or something went wrong during that deal. Maybe he was kidnapped, or I mean, a lot of things can go down. Maybe he was human trafficked. Those are just what I'm thinking because of just the clothes and everything. It's like his clothes are there, he's not there. Like everything is there though, like his fish, his wallet, everything is just on his backpack, just on the ground. Other people are saying it could be an alien abduction. Maybe it was like beamed up. I mean, that could very well happen. I believe in that stuff. Maybe he never left his apartment, or maybe he did leave his apartment and it wasn't him driving his car. Maybe, I mean, all his things were in there. So maybe when he was packing, something happened and they took his car. A lot of people believe that Jason was not actually the one driving his vehicle or using his phone, which, like I had said earlier, it's a lengthy passcode. So it could be someone he knew with him, or you know, they could have got the passcode out of him and then just kind of ditched him somewhere else. That's really all I have for this case. If there is any updates, I will update y'all. And I plan to do more true crime in the future. So if you have any cases that you want me to cover or look into, please comment below.